Hello everyone, welcome to this video session on embedded systems. I am Sandeep Saxena. In the previous video we have talked about the application level programmers model. So in the previous video we have seen the things from the application layer programmers perspective, and today we will see that what happens at the system level. So let's take an example of an operating system and just consider these figures. In one figure you can see that there is hardware is not included, but it describes the privilege level of each privilege level of the system, that how application layer things react. Or in the another figure you can see the system hardware, the kernel, the shell and the user. So you can see the application layer is the topmost layer which talks to the device driver, and then device driver talks to the kernel. So in this example you can see that the higher level APIs are responsible for providing the services to the application layer. That means at the application level we use APIs in our program which are responsible for the system calls. Basically the higher level APIs are used to provide the system calls. That's the reason we said earlier that user code can request the system to provide services. Why doesn't an application run in privileged access level? We have already seen in previous video. So in our case user can generate an SVC instruction, or user code can generate an SVC instruction to provide the system services. So I hope the concept of privileged execution has been clear now from that figure. A memory mapped architecture. So in ARM v7m there is a memory mapped architecture. So meaning that there is only physical addresses, and dereferencing a physical address can change its value. So that is the key point which we are gonna use in our programming part. So the address space from E million to FFFFF is reserved for the system level use. That means there will be some system related things. The first 1 MB of the address space from E million to E00FFFFF is reserved by ARM and known as the private peripheral bus. That means within this address space there are some peripherals which are used by the ARM. We will see what are those peripherals. With the rest of the address space is implementation defined with some memory attribute restrictions. That means there will be some conditions of using that particular memory. Within this PPB address space, a 4 KB block in range from E000 E00 to E000 EFFF is assigned for system control and is known as the system control space. In this system control space there are things like CPU ID registers, general control and configuration including the vector table base address, the system handler support, a system timer. Okay, what is this system timer? So this system timer is a hardware timer which is implemented in the processor core. So this is a 24-bit down counter and has a reload register which generates an exception when the reload register value reaches to zero. Software can also generate a systic exception in an OS environment. The processor can use this exception as the system tick. So this system timer can be used to implement a user delay function. It can also be used for CPU scheduling, or if you want to execute a task periodically it can also be used there. We can also measure time elapsed by using this timer. A nested vectored interrupt controller supporting 496 discrete external interrupts. All exceptions and interrupts share a common prioritization model. Fault status and control registers, the protected memory system architecture, processor debug. Modes, privilege and stacks. So these are the key concepts used in the ARMv7. Mode, the microcontroller provides profile supports two modes, thread and handler. In the previous architectures of ARM, there were like 7 modes of the processor. So in switching the states from one mode to another wastes some CPU cycle. That's why they made it like there will be only two modes, thread and handler mode. Handler mode is entered as the result of an exception. When we are dealing with an exception, obviously the processor would be in the handler mode. An exception return can be issued in handler mode. Thread mode is entered on reset. That means when we hit the reset, the processor mode is always the thread mode. But which stack pointer would it use? MSP. Yes. And can be entered as a result of an exception return. If we are returning from the exception, then there can also be the thread mode. Obviously, it would have to be thread mode. Privilege. Code can execute as privileged or unprivileged. We have talked about many times about privileged and unprivileged execution, so I don't think I need to explain these lines. Stack pointer. Two separate banked stack pointer exist, the main stack pointer and the process stack pointer. The main stack pointer can be used in either thread or handler mode. In the next slide we have a table which will give you a clear picture how does the stack pointer is used, how does PSP and MSP are used in the in different scenarios. So mode, privilege and stack relationship you can easily figure out from on this slide. As you can see, the first mode is privileged, mode is handler, and level is privileged, and the stack pointer is it is using the main stack pointer. What mode, what kind of scenario it can be? Obviously it would be at the time of the exception handling or the interrupt, or the interrupt handling, or when your ISR is running. Handler unprivileged, any, it is not possible. Handler cannot be an unprivileged in the unprivileged mode. Handler, any process, it is also the reserve combination because handler uses the MSP in our scenario. Thread, privilege, main, yes, this can happen. And when does it happen? When we hit the reset. Thread, privileged, process, it can also exist. Thread, unprivileged, main, is it possible? Yes, is it possible? Execution of an unprivileged process or thread using common stack in the system that supports privileged and unprivileged. Thread unprivileged process, yes, this is our user mode in which we write the application, or in the OS environment we write the application layer code. This is the same scenario. Exceptions. An exception is a condition that changes the normal flow control in a program. Exception behavior splits into two parts. Exception recognition, when exception event is generated and presented to the processor. Exception processing activation, when the processor is executing the exception and exception entry. So what can happen this time? This is the time when the exception is presented to the processor and how the processor managed to service it. So the processor, the exception is not normally serviced in the practical scenarios. There are so many things like stacking and unstacking, because you are running a program and you need to save the current state of the processor in somewhere. So you'll have to save the current process state of that your processor, and then you will have to service the exception. Otherwise you cannot return to the previous program you are running, or previous process or thread you are running. So that process is called the stacking and unstacking process. Stacking when you are saving the current state, and unstacking when you are returning from the ISR and you are doing unstacking by taking your contents as previous. Exceptions can be split into four categories: reset, supervisor call, faults, and interrupts. Reset is a special form of exception which terminates the current execution in a potentially unrecoverable way when the reset is asserted. That means if we hit the reset, then it will start executing from the reset handler, and it cannot be recovered where the last time the program counter was. Supervisor call. Supervisor call is a special type of instruction which is used in the operating system environment to issue a system call to the application layer. The SVC instruction enables the application to issue a system call that requires privileged access to the system and will execute program order with respect to the application. ARMv7M also supports an interrupt-driven service calling mechanism. Fault. A fault is an exception which results from an error condition due to instruction execution. Faults can be reported synchronously or asynchronously to the instruction which caused them. In general, faults are reported synchronously. That means those are done by us from our program code. The imprecise bus fault is an asynchronous fault supported in ARMv7M profile. A synchronous fault is always reported with the instruction which caused the fault. That means if we have used an instruction which caused some fault, it can be memory access violations or anything. An asynchronous fault does not guarantee how it is reported with respect to the instruction which caused the fault. That means those faults which are done by the hardware or which are presented, which are done asynchronously, then it cannot be said that how would it would be treated. Synchronous debug monitor exceptions are classified as fault. Watch points are asynchronous and treated as an interrupts. Watch points which we use in the debug state, when we connect the debugger with our system and we write a watch point, or we use a watch point to watch the control of the program, and when it reaches to that watch point, it generates an interrupt. Interrupt. An interrupt is an exception other than reset, fault, or a supervisor call. All interrupts are asynchronous to the instruction stream. That means those are not done by the instructions. That's why these are asynchronous, and it can be hardware generated also. Typically, interrupts are used by other elements within the system which wish to communicate with the processor. Each exception has a priority level, an exception number, a vector memory which defines the entry point or address for execution on taking the exception. That means when the exception is presented to the processor, then it jumps to some memory location which is the entry point of that exception, and it start executing from there, which is called the interrupt service routine, the ISR. Each synchronous exception other than reset is in one of the three possible states. An active exception is one which is not pending or active. That means the inactive exception is not the pending exception or the active exception. A pending exception is that kind of exception which is waiting to be serviced. And an active exception is the exception which is currently servicing by the processor. An active exception can be either running or preempted by a higher priority exception. If in the practical scenarios, if I am running a low level exception and at the same time the higher priority exception comes, then the previous exception would be preempted. Asynchronous exceptions can be in one of the three possible states or both pending and active at the same time. Where one instance the exception is active and a second instance the exception is pending. So this is the table with the exception number, IRQ number and the exception type, priority, vector address in the vector table, or the activation, how it is treated asynchronously or synchronously. So exception number 1 has the reset, so it has the highest priority and it is asynchronous exception. Second is NMI, the non-maskable interrupt, and third is the hard fault. Rest all interrupts are configurable. That means that can be configured by the software. Okay, so take a look on the fault and the other exceptions. Like, why reset is asynchronous? Because user can hit the reset at any time. That's why it is asynchronous and not related to the clock. NMI, it is also asynchronous. Hard fault, can't say, because it can be whether from the user code or it can be from the some other reasons. The memory management fault, it is synchronous. Why it is synchronous? Because if we try to access some memory which is not in our scope, or that is the reserved memory location, then obviously this fault would occur. That means this fault is occurred by the instruction. So that's why this is synchronous. SVC call is also synchronous. Usage fault, obviously this would be synchronous. And SysTick, it is asynchronous. Interrupt, asynchronous, we have already seen that. Priority levels and execution preemption. All exceptions are assigned a priority level. The exception priority. Three exceptions have fixed values, which we have seen in the previous table, while the others can be configured or altered by the software. An exception whose exception priority is sufficiently higher than the execution priority will become active, and the current process will get preempted and the exception is served. Exception return. When in handler mode, an exception handler can return. If the execution is both active and pending, second instance of the exception has occurred while it is being serviced, it is re-entered or becomes pending according to the prioritization rules. That means if the one ISR is running and the second ISR comes which has the higher priority, then what would happen? Obviously the second one would be running and the first one would be the preempted one. But if I am already, it is running a high priority ISR, then the next interrupt which has come would be the pending exception. The key information that was stacked is stored and execution returns to the code preempted by the exception. That means already I have discussed about the stacking and unstacking, so I think you can relate that thing with this. The exception return is determined by the exception return link. a value stored in the link register on the exception entry. Execution state. ARMv7M only executes thumb instruction, both 16-bit and 32-bit instruction, and hence it is always executing in the thumb state. So again, it is the high performance based thing in the ARM, how they made it, because if there would be two states like thumb 1 or thumb 2, then obviously there must be wastage of some clock cycles. So high performance. Debug state it entered when a core is configured to halt on a debug event and a debug event occurs. That means if we connect the debugger with the core, obviously that state would be entered. Registers. The ARMv7M profile has following registers closely coupled to the core. We have talked about the general purpose registers, the stack pointers, the link registers, the program counter, status registers, flags, exception, interrupt. I think these things have been discussed. The special purpose program status registers. The program status at the system level breaks down into three categories. They can be accessed as individual registers or a combination of any two from three, or a combination of all three using the MRS and MSR instructions. That means move to register from the special purpose register. We will see how these instructions work. The APSR, the application program status registers, user writable flags, we have discussed it in the previous video. The IPSR, the interrupt program status register, which tells the exception number what interrupt is currently being serviced. The execution program status register, the execution state bits, that means in which state our processor is. So these are the registers, the APSR, NZ, CVQ, we have discussed these flags. The IPSR, this tells the exception number. Yeah, one more thing I would like to tell, that ARM Cortex M3, M4 can service up to 256 exception from 0 to 255. That's why this register is 8-bit, in which 240 are the interrupts and 16 exceptions are there. The EPSR, the execution program status register, which tells that in which mode the currently the processor is running. There are some special registers for the interrupt and the for the priority values and other things, like the exception mask register, the primask. Primask and fault mask, both are the 1-bit value registers, and if we write into primask register, it disables all interrupts except the NMI. Or if we write to fault mask, it disables all interrupt except the NMI. Yeah, primask will also allow hard fault to occur, but if we write to fault mask, it will disable all except the NMI. Base PRI disables all interrupts of specific priority level or low priority level. It means that writing to this register, which has the 8-bit value, will deactivate all the interrupt from some priority level. That means from that base, all the interrupts would be inactive. Control. It has already been discussed that it is used to select the stack pointer. The special purpose control registers. The special purpose control register is a 2-bit register defined as follows. Bit 0 defines the thread mode privilege. Handler mode is always privileged. 0, thread mode has privileged access. 1, thread mode has the unprivileged access. bit one defines the stack to be used, SP or wo MSP or PSP. For thread mode, stack pointer process is used for current stack. For handler mode, this value is reserved. Software can update bit 1 in the thread mode. Explicit write from the handler mode are ignored. That means if we are in handler mode and we are trying to write into this bit, then obviously it would ignore, because if that it would work on that writing we done on that bit, it will it can generate a hard fault or something. That's why this thing is ignored here, this line. The bit is updated on exception entry and exception return. Exception model, this we will cover in when we will do the interrupts, because interrupt is a huge topic, so we will do interrupt on hardware also, so that time we will discuss the exception model. Thank you for watching.